Peatland cover only 3 to 5% of the Earth's surface, but yet store up to 30% of the Earth's carbon. But on the other hand, peatlands also fuel the livelihoods of many communities and many stakeholders and private sectors whose income depend on agricultural cultivation. And as a result, much of the peatland areas globally have been subject to draining for agricultural use and fall within areas that are licensed for present and future cultural production. While it is very easy to write off the situation as being a tragic trade-off between conservation and production, I believe that time is ripe for us to find integrated solutions that address both these needs that are vital to society. And so our focus today should be on reconciling production, protection, and inclusivity for the event today, and I have great panelists today to talk about that. Echoing the sentiment, the topic today will also be discussing the concerns, the role of private sector in identifying durable solutions for the use, management, conservation, and restoration of peatland while considering the economic, environmental, and social benefits. But I will go deeper than that in the discussion later. With that, I would like to introduce and welcome our panelists today, these three gentlemen. On my left is Mr. Darsono Hartono. I think he's very famous. I think all of you know who he is. He's the Chief Executive Officer of PT Rimba Makmur Utama, an Indonesian company that is developing the Katingan project, the Red Plus project, spanning 200,000 hectares of peat swamp forest in central Kalimantan. And in the as CEO, Darsono also oversees the company's work related to financing through the carbon market. He has extensive experience and knowledge in financial consulting and international banking, with previous positions at JP Morgan Chase and PwC. And then the gentleman in the middle is Mr. Michael Allen Brady. He's a senior forestry officer with IFC's Manufacturing Agribusiness and Services Advisory Team. He's based in Jakarta. He's managing IFC's forestry program in Asia and Africa. Michael has over 30 years of experience in Indonesia and throughout Southeast Asia on forest management, ecosystem restoration, and environmental impact analysis. He has held various private, public, and academic positions in sectors including forestry, pulp and paper, oil and gas, and mining. All extractive, of course. And the gentleman on the left is Pak Fitrian Ariansyah. He's the Indonesia Country Director at IDH, the Sustainable Trade Initiative. Fitrian has more than 17 years working experience in natural resource management and sustainable commodities, covering Indonesia, Australia, and Asia Pacific. He's also a board member of PISAGRO, our Partnership for Indonesian Sustainable Agriculture, a council member of Savit Challenge, TMA, World Economic Forum, regional council member in South Asia, and a core group member of IUCN on ecosystem management. Those are the three gentlemen for the session today. Now we will move on to hearing opening comments by each of the panelists on integrated and inclusive solutions for peatlands that encompass both production as well as conservation and restoration initiatives. But specifically, I would like us to talk about three things. Number one is about options. Number two is about challenges, and number three is about needs towards building durable, inclusive solutions that minimize economic and environmental trade-offs. Just to start with, I would like to make some comments about those three things. So number one is options. To reconcile production and protection in peatland landscape and need to prioritize. Encouraging approaches that equitably address protection, production, and inclusion, such as IDH, is led by Fitrian here. They have a peat production, protection, inclusivity concept, which I'm sure we will hear more about from Fitrian. I think it was recently launched in Davos, correct? And then part of options is also reducing deforestation and the incidence of fire. It's important that such approaches need to also emphasize disaster risk awareness and preparedness, especially on communities living in peat areas, and also increasing the potential for carbon sequestration of peat and reducing emission from degraded peat areas through rehabilitation and inclusive restoration practices. Through mechanism related to paludiculture and those that address subsidence. Element number two is about challenges. Some of the main challenges that exist for balancing economic benefits that are accrued from peatland, for peatland use from their larger social and environmental impact will include smallholder access to finance, to access economic gains, and to mitigate against risk. Number three is about needs, in terms of needs toward finding integrated solutions. So we need to, one, devise and mobilize innovative and inclusive funding instrument and project that combine farming and forestry interests. We need to create avenues to sustain projects that reduce deforestation and fire and also other source of greenhouse gas emissions, while enhancing the resilience of smallholders and communities by building their capacity for climate change, climate smart agricultural practices, which I know everything about it because in my previous position as, I was the managing director of sustainability of Asia Pulp and Paper Group until yesterday, so I know everything about this. So point number two is encouraging more research and strengthen the scientific knowledge base behind cropping methods such as paludiculture, intercropping, and agroforestry. Point three is raise consumer awareness, and point four also to increase environmental expertise about robust methods for restoration rehabilitations, because I think we need a lot to learn about that. Now, I will now ask our panelists for their comments on those three things: options, challenges, and needs to address multiple economic and environmental interests in peat landscapes, and to highlight the work their organizations have undertaken in this regard. So, Pak Darsono, could you start?
Thank you, Aida. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I think Aida gave a little preview of what my company is doing, but I know for some of you have not heard. I started my journey almost 10 years ago. Almost 10 years ago, you know, I just came back from New York. I was a banker, you know, and then this new acronym came out, REDD, REDD plus. So, you know, it's a, and then that's when I met my business partner, Rezal, whose father used to be Minister of Environment. And he started throwing me the idea of actually, you can protect, restore, and conserve forests and make money. Of course, my, you know, banking head and JP Morgan, New York came up, wow, that sounds like a good idea. So we started from an area that we look into peatlands, where a lot of people, this thing, imagine 10 years ago, peatlands actually has been studied. You know, there's a precedent of fire in 1998, but you know, I think it's not become a mainstream issue as we see right now. You know, everybody talk peatland, but 10 years ago, you know, we start looking into area, we find this area for 200,000 hectares, where it's still 90% intact. So even 90-95% intact. So, you know, of course, this is just a business idea coming up. But after, you know, fast forward 5 years, you know, the process of 10 years ago, and then you start evolving the issue of red plus. You know, we believe that, you know, at that time there was a Bali COP, and then there's a Copenhagen. There's a lot of hope that, you know, that there is a business opportunity to conserve and restore forests and make money. There was a hope. It's still a hope now. I mean, I'm still hopeful. But I think what has changed over that time is, you know, instead of us looking at it just to conserve and restore and being, you know, doing all the protection, suddenly we realize that the solution is not only protection, but there is need to be productive activities. There has to be production as well. So luckily in our side, just to give you an idea, it's like about 200,000 hectares from north to south, so 100 kilometers. And then east to west is about 30 kilometers. There's a two river system. So outside there's a buffer area where communities live. So when we look into this, the solution for us on long term, if you want to restore and conserve peatlands, is to make sure that the buffer area where the communities are productive. But productive in a way that is not cutting trees. Productive in a way that is not cutting the forest existing. So these are the things that we look into. You know, those are the basic options that we have on the table. But at the end, you know, the activity of restoring and conserving forests has to give benefit to whoever did it. You cannot just banking on the production only, because you cannot rely on the production, therefore there's a protection. Because just give you the very simple example in Riau. You think that, you know, you people are talking about increasing productivity, you know, no extensification, let's do intensification. But all these smallholders, eventually, you know, when they have 2 hectares, they have a motorcycle, then they're gonna have an Avanza, and the next thing they're gonna have a much better car, and then they're gonna have a second wife and third wife and fourth wife. How are we gonna handle that? That's an issue that we have to look at it on a longer term. I mean, you cannot expect that higher productivity will influence protection. If the protection itself doesn't give benefit to, or financial benefit to whoever did it. So these are the whole idea to have, you know, these are the option and the challenge. But I think, you know, what we learned, what I learned as coming from, you know, being purely entrepreneur 10 years ago, and I start realizing not only it's about climate change, not only it's about carbon credit, not only it's about dollars in terms of revenue, but it's actually at the end, the bottom line is about people. It's about communities who live in your area. It's about changing the way company doing business. It's about paradigm shift in terms of how company like us can be more transparent, how company, you know, has to be accountability in the system, there has to be professionalism in terms of how manage all these things. I mean, 10 years ago, I think, you know, the terms FPIC is not popular. Well, people talk about it, but now they require it. So there's a lot of things that, you know, evolve over time. And at the end, we have to find all those options available. And the key is to have to make sure there is a model that we're looking into right now is to, can we actually practice and execute what people has been talking about agroforestry in the peatlands? Because peatlands, I mean, the fact is, you know, in this buffer area, it's easy for me to say, let's just make it into palm oil or something that is monoculture based. But monoculture for me feels like if the farmer only know that they're planting a monoculture, all they want to do is going to be monoculture again, right? Once they increase, and when they hit that high productivity, then extensification will come, then we'll open more land. But we need to do is, you know, in this very field that we have been dreaming for the next 5-10 years is, you know, the buffer area that has been degraded, some of them has been community land, is to build their own forest, to build their backyard into a forest. So therefore they know the value of the forest that they're building, and behind them there are more forests so they can protect them. So these are the challenges that we have. And you know, for example, I went to the village a couple of years ago. One of the farmer came to me and said, "Padar Sono, the government, it's so easy for government to tell us not to burn, not to do slash and burn. But I've been doing it for years. What are my options now?" And I can tell you, if they come in, I'm going to bring this machine and I'm going to continue to burn. So, but these are real issues on the ground that we have to solve. I mean, when you talk about productivity, so I think we were lucky that, you know, 2 years ago we started investing in terms of how we can implement climate smart agriculture. What can we do by changing behavior, not slash and burn? So we've been doing this methodology. You can do cover cropping, you can do bacteria infusion. Those are the things that, you know, options that we put on the table for communities that to change behavior. I mean, at the end, when I said options, challenge is always there, but the option is we always give the communities to choose. Those are the jobs that we need to give. You know, it's up to them. You have to help them transparently. We tell them what we can do. And, you know, I just came back just to give you an example. Today we have the, we managed to, that out of these 200,000 hectares, there are 34 village head, you know, 34 villages in the area. We're currently having a training for these 34 villages head right now in Jakarta, you know, to talk about how can they manage these natural resources that they have. So as a company, not only that we're looking on the production or protection, we also have to help the communities. You know, we have, today we bring a speaker, we work with Kemitraan in terms of doing this small workshop and capacity building for this village head. You know, we have a speaker from the Minister of Village. We have a former KPK chairman, Pak Busro, who has to come and tell them. So there's a lot of dynamic things that have to be done. People cannot just rely on, you know, oh, let's not do it. You have to look at the bottom line, what the ecosystem and the people provide you. Then you go that solution. So every solution can be unique in peatland. The peatland in Central Kalimantan might be different than Riau and Sumsel. But I think if you really deep down, deep into the individual or, you know, the villages and understand them more, then the solution itself will come out. You know, how you can balance that production and protection. You know, you can learn so much from them. And sometimes, you know, all you need is just to listen and do all those stuff. So the solution is actually right there. It's a matter of, are you willing to do it? And of course, the key challenge is always in the finance. You know, I mean, there's a reality that, you know, if a company like us cannot be sustainable financially, all this good work that we are doing is not going to happen. So, but I think what we are pushing is we want to show to the world that on a level where we can manage this as a private sector, willing to work transparently with NGO, with the government, with the communities, and there is a way of making money together. There is a way of prosperity. There is a way of, you know, mitigating climate change. So I think I'm still hopeful. Just for your example, you know, I've been doing it for 10 years, we haven't been making money. But it doesn't mean that, you know, we will stop. Some people will probably give up, but I think for me, it's about changing the way we do things in land use. If we can actually have a good paradigm change, sustainability path, not just from a climate perspective, but everything from the business itself is going to come. So Indonesia right now is in the brink of changing things. You know, there's a lot of regulation. I mean, if you look at the government, they start consulting with private sector, so making the regulation with the NGO. So all these three parties, in terms of how we do things, are start moving. So I'm hopeful. I think, of course, there are a lot of challenges, but again, every peatland is unique. You just have to find, because it's involving people. Because people are unique. So you just have to find a solution out there. That's it.
Thank you, Pak Darsono. I would like to move on to Fitrian first, Michael, because I hope that you can actually come up with a solution at the end, financial solution. So Fitrian, if you don't mind, you just explain further about the IDHU concept, production, protection, and inclusivity, the options out there, the challenges that you already foresee because it's a new program, and also what is needed, what kind of science, and what kind of instruments are needed to make sure that this PPI program will succeed in the future.
Thank you, Aida. Prior to talking about the PPI, production protection inclusions concept, and the fund associated with that we launched in Davos in January this year, I would like to get back a bit of our basic platform of IDH. Perhaps some of you may have not known. I mean, we are in the business of promoting and encouraging sustainable commodity productions, working together with the private sector. So we are not the private sector. We're just trying to be friends and working together with the private sector and encouraging them as much as we can to change their business practices, like what Dasan has mentioned before. But when it comes to peat, it's a bit much complex than the mineral soil altogether, perhaps because of the long history of fires, long history of course, of conversion and the versatility of the peat when it is converted. So I think when it comes to trying to achieve the balancing economic productivity, as well as protections of the peat ecosystem, as well as inclusivity of smallholders and village farmers, we need also to think relatively big in the beginning. It's about zoning, it's about landscape. I mean, I think in the beginning of this event, people talk also about landscape. Zoning also consists of macro and also micro zoning or zonations. In the macro one, we need also to think carefully what sort of ecosystem or hydrological system of the peat. So people is important, but I think also we need to also look at in the context of that, the bigger chunk of where's the conservation, so where's the peat dome, where's the areas that can, you know, be developed productively without having to lead to negative impacts on the peat, for instance. And then, of course, the crucial part of the water management of the ecosystem. And, of course, because of we are in Indonesia, we need to talk of this in combination with fire prevention and mitigation. I think a combination of zoning, water management, fire prevention and control, and, of course, eventually of peat restorations. The components of the private sector that would lead to the concept of productivity or production, protection, inclusion would be then crucial, because if you talk about this kind of big landscape, I don't think anybody would be able to support the investment, support interventions of getting the balance right if there's no involvement of the private sector. Not talking yet about the funding, it's about also capacity. Just be truthful to ourselves on the ground, for instance. I'm not talking about the existing practices, but if you talk about the potential, who are, for instance, that have the capability to get to the farmers, because they are the farmers are the suppliers of this part of the commodities of supply chain, the farmer sector, the mills, for instance, when it comes to palm oil, the processing facility when it comes to coffee, cocoa, or whatever commodities that we talk in those landscapes. But sometimes the productivity infrastructure, so to speak, the commodity supply chain up to now is not necessarily associated with the protections infrastructure. So I think we need to also to link this together. That's why the intervention and investment, you know, when it comes to productivity, protection, and inclusion needs to be combined. But of course, like Dasona said, the private sector or even the farmers, they are hesitant to go beyond their usual practices if there's no incentives. Incentives should come or could come, of course, first from the policy parts of the government. For instance, what we have been doing with some palm oil companies in Jambi, in South Sumatra, in West Kalimantan, to provide some support for land legality that would help farmers to have this kind of certainties to cultivate the land, but also think out loud about what sort of areas that they need to be protected and so forth. But more to the talking about the big investment, this is probably one of the biggest headaches of not only companies in Indonesia, but also companies along the supply chain at the global level. So that's why when we decided to, let's say, entertain the notions of this fund of $400 million that can be used for the risking facility, so that perhaps mainstream financial institutions or banks can also see there's an opportunity or option to invest in those smallholders, in those suppliers, to improve their productivity. In return then, they can also protect the remaining ecosystem. We do hope with this kind of combinations or arrangement, new investment could come in, new interventions in the context of doing the commodity as productive as possible while also entertaining the ideas of protecting or also restoring the peat ecosystem would be much clarified and also would be much viable. Why? Because I think we can't talk about restoring peat or protecting peat if the farmers, for instance, can only produce 3 tons per hectare of palm. Or if they can sell only at really the threshold level of the price at the global level of coffee, of cocoa, or of rubber, for instance. We need to support these kind of activities, and also in the long run, there won't be any support for productivity without this kind of investment. Replanting of palm, for instance, I mean, if you want to ask the smallholder not to go to the remaining peat, you have to support the replanting of the smallholders of palm in the existing areas, for instance. We calculated across Indonesia, we need at least $4 billion of investment for replanting. That's not really a small scale in that sense. Indonesia has the BPDP CAS, which is the CPO fund. But this is a starting point. We need also some other companies to support. In return, when you ask the suppliers, smallholders, and also companies to invest for protections, there's another ballpark figure of costs to do the canal blockings. I think Aida knows much better than me. It's like thousands of dollars per dam or per costs required to do that kind of things in a landscape, for instance, so more than that. $500 per dam, for instance. So you can't ask smallholders, for instance, to do that without some support. So whatever productivity support or support for productivity needs to be combined with the protection support. I think some companies did it in the context of fire-free villages, but this is just a starting point. I mean, fire prevention and control is like one small step to go. But more to that is how then we can ensure that farmers know exactly or understand the protocol of the management of the land. We've been trying that in some areas in Rio. To some extent get some success factors, but also a result, but also some other questions, I mean, in the long run. So it's not that easy, but we see good hopes. For instance, this is my last remark, if, for instance, those private sector companies or corporations that are stations in one particular landscape work together hand in hand. In South Sumatra, in Musi Banyuasin, we're trying our best to work together with the different partners to have different meals, to collaborate, to have this kind of jurisdiction of verified sourcing area for sustainable palm. Because with that, we do hope that there won't be any leakage for, you know, bad practices to happen. In West Kalimantan, different concession also, we encourage to share best practices of peat and water management. Because yes, people can say one company needs to do much better than the others, but usually these companies do not talk to each other because they're competitors or they basically have different interests. So how can these type of things also be combined, also be facilitated? So it's not only about investment, but it's also about communication, it's about coordination, it's about sharing, it's about being open-minded in the context of, you know, boosting productivity, but also ensuring that the protections of the remaining ecosystem in the landscape be done properly. Thank you.
Thank you, Fitrian. So, Michael, what do you think? What is the opinion of IFC based on the work that you've done to discuss about these three elements?
Thanks, Aida. Good afternoon. Salam sejahtera. I've joined IFC in 2011. I manage our forestry program, so I'm going to keep most of my comments focused on peatland forestry. And I'll also start with a little bit of qualification. We have not invested in forestry, upstream forestry on peatlands in Indonesia. So that's an important point to keep in mind. That's my big mission, is to help you know, our first investment. We have looked very carefully at on peat plantations, mainly fast-growing timber. We've also looked very carefully at payment for ecosystem services or forest carbon credit programs. Again, we haven't been successful, although we did just issue our first forest carbon bond late last year. That was for a project in Africa, but we did look at projects here, and there's some of you and I need to talk. But I'd like to go back and give you a little bit broader perspective on peatlands and use my background to provide that perspective. Peatland development is not just oil palm and pulp plantations. Or starting my career on peat in a small community called Tuktayaktuk in Northwest Territories in Canada, I looked at frozen peat and quickly lost interest and found myself in Palembang, South Sumatra a few months later looking at much more interesting tropical peatlands, and spent about 8 years doing a graduate degree on peatlands in South Sumatra and Riau province. I also had an opportunity to work on transmigration, lowland transmigration, mainly in Sumatra back in the early 80s, and so had a lot of very rich observations about development of peatlands, mainly for agriculture and settlement. I then worked up in Riau in the oil and gas industry, again on peatlands, and so got a flavor of the impacts and management needs on peatlands in the extractive sector. Then moved into peat fire science and management, and spent about a decade researching and developing systems for early warning of peat fires, ignition. That's given me a pretty broad background to get into the banking industry. And I guess I'd put a plug in for IFC that IFC's been here for 60 years. So they've got lots of patience for investment in Indonesia. And they hire people like me that have got, you know, strong technical backgrounds. Ernest Beeth, who I think you heard in the previous section, both he and I work in agribusiness and forestry. So that's a little bit of background to provide some context for the three issues that I wanted to address that Ida mentioned. I guess from a commercial perspective and working for a bank, that's really my main mandate. I'd love to look at other issues, but commercial viability for investment, return on investment is a critical focus. And I've certainly been forced to look at that perspective in my current work. So the real big challenge is how can we look at investments, viable investments, with environment and social sustainability considerations for high intensity, high productivity development in peat areas. Thinking specifically of plantations, and I think we still are very much challenged to find ways. I think in the short term we can achieve high productivity, high intensity work, but the sustainability, both from a biophysical and social perspective, I think there's still a lot of questions as to whether we can achieve that. So there is short-term commercial viability. Longer term, it's still, you know, the question's still out. So the alternative is lower productivity. You know, can we develop commercially viable enterprise, whether that's big or small, on lower productivity, less intensive use of peatlands? I would say I'm a little bit skeptical, but remain open to that. Pollutification is certainly being explored now, but whether that can be commercially viable, again, at a large or small scale, you know, I think there's still a lot of challenges there. My personal view is that and perhaps reflecting my forestry background, I believe that natural forest management is probably one of the best options, where you don't have drainage, you're managing the landscape at a much, much longer time frame with you know, with good silviculture. So that if pollutification and you know, community-based forestry can move towards that, then that's, you know, I think that's a very good option. So that level of intensity of using land and the extensive nature, you know, our extensive areas for natural forestry available these days? Can enterprise access, given the challenges of land tenure, you know, can enterprise access such, you know, large areas to have much less intense activities? So again, another challenge. Some of the options, we're looking at companies that are still trying to achieve high productivity, high intense activities in the plantation sector while maintaining the integrity of peat hydrology, soil conditions, and I think that activity should be allowed to continue. That we should promote companies to pilot and you know, provide outreach on results of these efforts. There's still a lot of uncertainty. We, you know, we're all aware of the 0.4 meter water table depth restriction. Whether fast-growing species can grow at a high enough rate at that and under those conditions is still, I don't think we've had a full rotation yet under those new requirements. Another option is to accept the land use change. If we look at the transmigration program back in the, well, I guess going back to the 100 years ago, but mainly 60s and 70s, so if you look at some of the transmigration areas that were peat, my own experience in South Sumatra, the peat that was there, up to 8 meters, is completely gone. And yet these settlements, in some cases, in some areas, are doing very well. So fate had it that that peat disappeared, and the price has been that there are communities that are now, I think, quite sustainable. We see other areas where peat has subsided, and there are issues of flooding, sea level rise, inundation. I think, Al, you're one of the experts in the room on that issue. So that acceptance of a land use change and you know, degradation to peat is an option in some cases. Restoration to sustainable forest management. I think that's another option that we should be looking at in our definition of restoration. Restoration to community-based agroforestry, which I think is what we most like often, that's how we most often view peat restoration at the community level. Whether that can be commercially sustainable, you know, from an investment perspective, although the investments might be small, we don't know the answers to that. And I think that's something we do need to look at the financing and the investment aspect of that, you know, element of restoration. So those are some of the options that I think we are and need to look at more intensively. Some of the needs, I think we're all aware of the mapping and classification activities of peatlands, the work of both the Ministry of Environment and Forestry as well as BRG. That mapping activity, I think, needs to continue. The classification of conservation and use areas, or protection, I guess, and use areas needs to be more and more refined, and we're seeing that happen. I think we also need to better define conservation goals. There are large areas of Indonesian peatlands that are naturally in a state of degradation. You know, climate has changed. Regional topography, river systems have changed. Some of these peatlands are naturally degrading, whether they're disturbed by human activity or not. You know, are those areas really important for conservation, or do we try to identify the peatlands where peat is still accumulating, or at least maintaining a steady state? And should those really be our conservation priority areas? I would argue that they should be. And finally, a strong need from a private sector perspective is to closely look at the impacts of exiting. In areas that have been mapped as conservation or protected peatlands, there is a real issue now of private sector perhaps needing to leave, abandon these areas, at the end of the current rotations. And I think we really need to understand the impacts, both to the economy, to the local socioeconomic setting, and to the peat itself. You know, is, for example, a plantation on 1 meter of peat really worth abandoning assuming that you're going to be able to restore that 1 meter before it completely disappears. Those are tough issues to balance. But I think the impacts of, we really need to understand the costs and benefits before we start exiting. And the impacts that will do on the private sector and on the investment community. I think we're starting to see that in the last few weeks. That issue is now coming into the media. So those are a couple of the needs, and I'll end it there. Thank you.
Thanks, Michael. I think everybody kind of agree that it's more about people. If you want to resolve issues surrounding peatland, it's about people. That's what I get from the three gentlemen over here. So I want to talk a little bit about the elephant in the room that Michael already mentioned before, paludiculture or paludification. Because like Darsona, let me start with Darsona and after that with Fitran. Darsona, your concessions is also located on peat. And as Michael said before, it's almost impossible to find alternative species with a shorter rotation and higher productivity. What is your strategy in dealing with this? Because it's not much point of protecting forest in your concession, involving the community if you still encourage them to plant trees or species that still requires massive drainage. So what is your strategy in dealing with the situation in this your concession, and maybe also for Fijian for your combination of production and protection? And you said increase yield, but what if that increased yield still require massive drainage at the same time? So gentlemen, if you can respond to that.
So I think this is what we're trying to find a solution. I mean, we've been working very hard in terms of finding options. But I can tell you that, we look into a lot of, again, this is agro, the model will be more agroforestry model. So we're trying to basically, what we're doing, a lot of this in our buffer area where communities live in their villages, they're all degraded, so shallow peat, degraded. So what we're looking for is basically trying to identify what type of commodities, how can we diversify the commodities so they are not in the risk for just single commodity product. So we're looking into something like pineapple. Now we're testing vanilla. We basically high value product coming out, right? I mean, we're not talking about eucalyptus and chopping it. We're not talking about commercial plantation, tree plantation kind of model. We're looking into building into more of a non-timber product model. So, we're looking to vanilla. We're even looking for something like jatropha, for energy. So these are the options that we're looking. I mean, I cannot be sure what it is, but we're testing. But the problem is, the good thing is we are solving the soil problem. The reality is, that every year this area always going a lot of fires. We start changing the behavior of the communities not to do slash and burn. So once we fix the soil and get the soil fertility back, there's a lot of productivity increase. They can actually just plant rice. And then usually when they plant rice, their productivity is only for themselves. Now they can have more productivity. They have more yield that they can start selling it. So when you talk about, productivity, you have to look at it for what they do. I'm not trying to change behavior in the community if we could. Just do whatever and just increase productivity. Then what Michael's saying is exactly right. Is this economically viable for a company to invest? That's the reality. The reality might be viable for the communities that we invest in. But in the meantime, the company like us have to protect and restore and help all this effort. To be honest with you, without the income from generating from the carbon credit or the ecosystem payment, basically environmental services, this is not going to work. Because there's so much cost, from the licensing cost, from operational cost, that it will not be viable. That's why a lot of people are not following our lead. It's like in a point where I've been doing this for almost 9 years, just as testing the market and see where they are. But if another 4 or 5 years or even, there's really no sign of market in terms of benefiting for people who protect and restore peatlands financially, the model is not going to ever work. That's just the reality. There has to be a way that we have to be innovative to find the financing. I mean, what our company is doing is sort of like trying to bridge that gap. I mean, my hope is in the next 20 years, our concession in 30 years from now will be run by communities and have that. So sometimes you need private sector intervention. to do all these things. I mean, we strongly believe in equal stakeholder, you know, equity with communities, because at the end of the day, we need them to help us to protect. So it's still a business case that is need to be challenged to a point where there is no sustainable finance coming in. So, I mean, I'm familiar with what Michael just mentioned, which is kind of good just to give you some idea what Michael mentioned about this forest carbon bond that they structure. So I think this is kind of a, I know that you're probably working on it for like 2-3 years to do that. I mean, you know, I know that you're looking to our project in Indonesia. Our project was not qualified yet then. So, you know, we're not part of the due diligence. But I think this innovative financing is quite amazing. Just to give you an example, I'll just give you a detail of the structure. So basically, IFC issued a bond, which is a typical bond, which is, you know, whatever the credit risk on IFC. But instead of paying the bond, a typical coupon of cash, they paid a carbon credit. So they pay carbon credit on their coupon. So now you're asking, as a bondholder, why would I want to take carbon credit? Right? There's no value in carbon credit. Somebody claim it's $5, but who knows? There's really no market making yet in that space. But the good thing is there is an institution, I think it was PHP, guarantee that coupon. Carbon pricing, in a way. But in whatever the carbon coupon, the coupon that is paid in a carbon credit, they guarantee of a certain amount of money. That if it's below that, you know, they were willing to pay. So, you know, this will create market incentive. So I think these are the things that I think we'll see forward more. We need basically the multilateral, all this, you know, the World Bank, all this to prime the pump and create the market and start giving incentive. Because every, you know, just to give you a prospect of how big this market can be. In Indonesia, there's a lot of existing hapeha. We're talking beyond peatland now. There's a lot of natural forest logging concession available, and I've been spoken with a lot of this the owner, and they say that so if your model work, we will want to convert our logging concession into your model. You know, maybe timber is no longer a viable product that we are selling. Maybe it's the ecosystem, the environmental services is going to be the next trend. So, but unfortunately, we are just stuck. I mean, we're still there. We're not there yet. So let's hope that somebody like IFC keep on doing what they're doing to create the market making. So.
Just to comment that. And we're looking to repeat it.
Thank you, Aida. I think I would start by saying that there's no silver bullet, and it's about income. It doesn't matter, I think, whether commodities are palm, acacia, or sago, or fruits and veggies, rubber, or whatever. At the end of the day, farmers, suppliers, small to medium enterprises would like to see in the balance sheet that they're getting profit. So when it comes to boost productivity, I think we need to understand first the supply chain of those commodities in the landscape or in the jurisdictions, and whether we can utilize the existing infrastructure and whether we can fill the gaps that are not there yet. I'm trying to use, for instance, a particular concrete example in South Sumatra, especially in the district of Musi Banyuasin. Yes, they are palm oil smallholders, but they are also rubbers, as well as paddies, rice, I mean, and also some other non-timber forest products, as well as fishery and stuff like that. So the challenging part would be, first, if you want to convince people to convert the commodities to other type of productivity that does not require drainage, the infrastructure is not there. So there's need to have an investment of this kind of infrastructure of supply chain, and we can't work to, you know, solely without the involvement of the local government. That's why I think the combinations of the support of the Bupati, as well as different mills, as well as different private sector players, would then be providing this kind of platform to show that if we want to change for farmers to change the commodities into different commodities, then in the long run, in the medium run, for instance, there will be some provisions of this kind of supply chain infrastructure. Investment needs then to be directed to that. That can't be done without the signals coming from the local government for, let's say, investing in some sort of processing facility or different corporate partners that also think out loud about those different commodities, because without their support, the access to market will not be realized, the access to finance will not be realized. I think the banking will not also get involved and support this kind of investment of new commodities without the involvement of smallholders. Going to West Kalimantan, for instance, there are like village forests that we support. Now they're trying to test and try out charcoal, biochar, charcoal, hopefully would be then exported to Japan and Korea with the support of Blantara, for instance. But this cannot be done if the processing facility is not developed. So those farmers now are learning in Java, and then also talking to the district government whether this can also be set or establish this kind of processing facility. And then we need to then convince the financial institution to come in and see whether investment in this kind of thing is risky. We also, part of Peace Agro, for instance, talking with those big names that have this kind of experience in getting those kind of different commodities to be supported. And of course, it's not that easy. So that's one of the things. So while waiting for that, which is crucial in my view, is that can we see even the mainstream commodities that farmers are doing now can still be boosted in terms of the productivity? More and more we realize that smallholder farmers, even small to medium enterprises, they're not doing their production effectively. Why? Perhaps because the provisions of exchange services is not there. Farmers' organization is also not strong enough, or is not yet there. The cooperatives, for instance, are not yet there, and so forth. And because of that, good agriculture practices are also not there. So can we also do something about this? Getting some helps from sectors that are already there, from sector partners, to lend hands, can be part of the fire-free villages, can be part of the supply chain corporations with those farmers, and so forth. At the end, I think we need to combine different type of interventions because if we just directly say that you have to change your commodities into something that don't require that kind of extensive drainage, I think farmers need to be convinced. And while doing that, you need also to provide some sort of medium or midterm interventions that could also require different type of investment.
More complicated the more we talk about it. So we have 15 to 20 more minutes for question and answer with everybody here. I think the more we talk about this, I think the more we feel the need of some kind of a new system to make peatland protection a profitable business. And I think we do need to look up to private sectors or others to actually create some kind of pilot, but also come up with a clear roadmap on how to get there. Establish or to create alternative species that would work well on peatland or undrained peatland. The research, the pilot, and how to make it commercially viable. Large scale planting viable, that will require time. How many years do we need to achieve there? I think there's no clear map to go there. But on that note, I'm gonna give it to the audience. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask questions to the three gentlemen here. Yes? Somebody? Could you please state your name and the organization you work for?
Hello, good afternoon. I'm Amlia Borgana. I'm from the World Agroforestry Center. Thank you very much for providing us with such good inputs. I was thinking about the talk that you just heard from the three of you. It all comes down into what I call a 4P model, the people, public-private partnership. In my view, it's about commitment. And the stakeholder view, I think they have each different goals. People need support an increase in household income, private profit, obviously, public provision, and it would be great to see or to hear about your perspective on that. Thank you.
Any more questions before we answer that one? Why don't we?
I think, you know, the whole concept of public-private people partnerships is where the future has to go. That's the reality. It's just that right now, we have not found the right recipe how to get there. I mean, one thing, there's a lot of things that has, I mean, you have to go back in terms of history, how, you know, where we are now. There's a lot of, from, you know, especially in company in the land use sector, you see like a lot of communities don't trust company in this. There's a lot of mistrust among the parties. I think we have to, again, it's about commitment and it's about trust and how we communicate those things. So these things, you know, we are calling for private sectors to be more transparent, but I think in the meantime, I'm calling for the people to be more acceptance. There's a lot of things that have to be done. And only when you, I mean, I can tell you the reason why we are where we are now. It's after, you know, almost 10 years, we are consistently and transparently putting our effort throughout the time. That's how we gain trust. But the reality is, bankers said, no, we need return. But so we live in a world that is just mismatched in terms of what we're trying to achieve and what's the reality. Of course, you know, you can, you know, people say, oh, everybody, oh, we're a long-term player, we're long-term players, you know, we look at long-term result, long-term player. But after 1 year, we're not making money, they come, that's all, what's going on? But that's the reality. But how do we bridge that? Maybe, you know, we have to look into more, I mean, innovative financing from a philanthropic mechanism that can see the value. Because some investors just need to be educated. Of course, when you talk to Wall Street investors, they don't. They said, oh, it's a long-term, we look long-term view. 3 hours later, they changed their view. They're not even that long-term. So I think there's a gap of that. But I think only if a private sector willing to do all the work could be consistent and willing to do what people said, a free, prior, informed consent. I mean, to the investment, our investment of 9 years in communities is going to make our life easier for the next 20 years. But that's rather than getting the license now, work on it from a government perspective, from a license perspective, and start dealing with communities. It's not the way anymore. I mean, this is the only blessing in disguise of my case is it took me 5 years to get my license. But those 5 years are the most valuable 5 years because that's where you really can gain trust from communities. But I'm not suggesting that companies have to wait for 5 years to get their license. There are more ways to be more efficient. You just have to be there. I mean, you know, as a board of directors, we go to village by village. There's a lot of effort that you have to put as a leader of a company to push to get that trust because you have to earn that trust. So we're only with the trust then we can actually have that, you know, the PPPP. Otherwise, we're still a long way.
Just a few comments on the four P's. I fully agree, and I think some of the constraints relate to, as Darsono mentioned, good information amongst the four P's. So things like free, prior, and informed consent, which is a requirement for IFC and our performance standard number 6 for Indigenous peoples. We've had experience that is very much worth the effort. You know, prior to an investment, helping companies to apply FPIC well provides a huge amount of information to local communities and can promote much better partnerships. So I think you also said we're stuck and that we want to invest quickly. But we also have, in our case, some very rigorous environment and social safeguards. And if we can't apply those, then we won't invest. And we've got the luxury, I guess, of being able to, you know, as I said, we've been here for 60 years and haven't been able to invest in upstream forestry. I think land issues are another constraint to the successful four P's. Until land holders have better tenure to land, that they'll never really be equal players among the four P's. And we see some movement there, but land access is certainly still a major issue for investment and successful partnerships.
Just to add to our experience, and perhaps I would like to show you a particular model that we've been introducing or trying out in the context of sustainable commodity production that can relate to this PPPP. Is it four or five? Basically, whenever we are doing things in sustainable palm oil, coffee, cocoa, aquaculture, timber, for instance, we're trying to, I don't know whether you can see it, but at least there are like five components that need to be there for supporting this proper PPP in our view. One is there's a need for a good aggregator. In the context of commodities, it could be cooperatives, local companies, for instance, or traders that can support farmers or smallholders or villagers that can be able to then enhance the capacity in managing themselves, because without that, they will be always be marginalized. And the provisions of good agricultural practices from whoever, could be extension services coming from companies or government or privately led extension services. This can also be combined with the issues of fire control or fire management, pit management, water table management, and so forth. But of course, the most important thing when it comes to the fourth fee is the off-taking agreement. So the off-takers, the ones that would buy the commodities, should be there, should also have this kind of pledges and commitment towards sustainability. And last but not least is the involvement of the financial institutions. We don't need to talk about big financial institutions in the very beginning, because the competition is not with all due respect, not with IFC. I mean, the competition is with the loan sharks. Competition is with the local traders that give right away investment with really high interest rate, but concrete cash. So you need to come up with some sort of structure of a financial scheme in which farmer can see all the money is there, but in return, if they get this money in return, they need to take care of some of the sustainability components, including pit management and water management, for instance. We have been trying this for mangroves and aquaculture in Aceh to some extent, kind of get successful outcome. They now, in terms of period, we also try to divide this into three periods. One is pre-investment or pre-commercial investment interventions. So this is some sort of intervention that need to be there without the involvement of commercial arms or companies, because I think companies would not do that. So this is like land legality, for instance, establishment of cooperatives and so forth, or maybe they will get involved, but not to the extent of quite large. This needs to get some sort of involvement of the local governments. That's why the public role is important. The second layer of the second period is the transition fund. It's like blended finance. You still provide grant for this cooperatives or farmers organization, but then you can introduce already some sort of commercial soft loan investment to farmers with microfinance or whatever scheme. And after that, they need to graduate into commercial investment. Like Darsono said, and also Michael, I think this requires time. But you need also to get this kind of understanding with off-takers, with the private sector. The big one usually have this kind of also big ideas, also big projections of what can be done in the long run. So if this type of things could be then applied, most likely, again, there's no silver bullet, most likely things bit by bit can be changed.
Okay. One more question and that's it. Yes.
My name is Hans Joost, the Kruisland Meyer Center. I think that with respect to the problems and the urgency and the importance, it is good to differentiate between the different issues. And with respect to drained peatlands, we have actually four types of problems. First, fire and haze. And of course, that is dependent on drainage, but we know that we can stop that by good management. And drained peatlands do not have to burn. Simple as that. It's a matter of management. Then we have the issue of carbon emissions, greenhouse gas emissions, which is strongly depending on the depth of drainage. It's an almost linear relationship. And there we must be aware that a layer of 15 centimeters of peat has the same carbon content as a high carbon stock forest. So it is a matter of global priority and also global financing to address that. And the last and maybe the most important issue is subsidence. Of course, there are peatlands that when the peat has gone, that you have a nice mineral soil left. But in very many, maybe most peatlands, you will have acid sulfide soils, or you have water. You change land in non-land. And that is, of course, the most important issue on the long run. And there you can simply calculate how much time you have to develop alternatives. And these alternatives can only be wet-based production functions, like paludiculture. And you can calculate it from how high these areas above the sea level, how deep they are drained, how fast they go down. And then you know, okay, there are areas where you have to develop these alternatives in 10, 15, 30, 50. It's very differentiated. But otherwise, you will lose the productive land in a time that we can allow us least to lose productive land.
Unless you dam the whole island. Like the Netherlands. I would like maybe Michael to answer this question. Does IFC have some kind of programs to try to solve these issues about paludiculture, to come up with a long-term program to prevent subsidence and everything else? Do we actually have this? Because nobody actually leading this right now. I mean, my previous company tried to do that, so I hope they continue. But do we have any finance system to support this?
I guess the simple answer is no. IFC doesn't focus on peatlands. What we do is apply our performance standards, which address many of the concerns that that land, the affluent sector. Faces biodiversity issues, ecosystem services issues, all of the social issues. People like me working in IFC have our technical expertise, and that's what we base a lot of our decisions on. But as I said earlier, it's a fairly hard-nosed business, and if a commercial enterprise on peat does not look sustainable over multiple rotations, we wouldn't go near it. I mean, our credit officers who only look at numbers and rates of return, they would jump on that right away with the environment and social safeguards as an additional consideration. So it's that commercial viability for IFC, our time horizon is typically longer than a normal commercial bank. We invest in enterprise usually for 5 to 10 years. We have a focus on repeat business. So we want to work with good companies that have a long-term perspective. And we're pretty good about weeding out the shysters and the investors that are in it for the short term. So unfortunately, we have not been able to invest in peatlands for the reasons I've just mentioned. That doesn't mean that we've given up. Otherwise, I'd be I guess in your position, looking for new options. But I hope that answers the question.
To close this discussion, I think this is a very complicated issue, but ideally, if I can actually come up with my wish on what needs to be done, is that someone needs to basically step up and come up with a clear, hopefully the government, ideally it's the government, to come up with a clear roadmap on how to achieve this alternative species, either for pulp and paper, or for palm, or for others, or plant, or totally changing the species like Darsono vanilla or other crops. Ideally, the government should come up with a clear roadmap. I don't know, is it 5 or 10 years? And you know, like within 5 years, we're doing a research, we're doing a pilot for alternative species. Within 5 years, how many canals can be dammed, can be stopped? And you know, within 10 years, how many centimeter of water we can actually increase to achieve the target? That needs to be outlined properly. And have a clear roadmap and stages that need to be done, and the clearer responsibility of private sector, NGO, local government have to be clear as well. I think that's one thing that I can learn from here, and then again, the question still, you know, how can we think together to make sure that protecting peatland can be changed into something that, into a profitable business. That's the only way to save peatland. On that note, I thank very much to the three panelists and everybody is here. Thank you for your contribution and question and everything else. Good afternoon. Thank you.